Hello everyone, Prime here, and today we're going to be going over the strongest gods in Smite. Specifically, who exactly out of the Assassins of Smite is the strongest? Before we get into this, we're just going to quickly talk about Dudgy. According to Smite's lore, Dudgy reveled in torture and malice. She took delight in their screams of pain as she danced to playful music composed at her command, musicians trembling for their every note. So grievous did these atrocities grow that the people rose up and overthrew their ruler. They stormed the gates, toppled the throne, and pursued Zhao to his bedchamber. Yet Dudgy managed to escape and conceal herself. Now she joins the fray. This is all very well and good, but in Chinese mythology, Dudgy doesn't escape. She's caught by Nuar, Erlang Shen, and Nja. They all have some sort of battle with her. Not necessarily at the same time, but they do have some sort of conflict with her, and this leads to her execution. I mention this to show off the point that Smite's in-game lore is different from the original mythology that these gods and goddesses are from. That doesn't mean that the original mythology isn't useful here, because a lot of these stories are still derived from the original mythologies themselves, but some of those original mythologies might be changed. Now, of course, for Dudgy specifically, this difference in her story shows off different skills that she might have, with Smite showing off how much of the assassin traits she sort of has in her bodies, whereas her real lore just showing off her raw power. So I'm not going to be covering every single assassin, and I'm also comparing these assassins based on their physical strength, their magical strength and other abilities and utilities, their speed, and how good I think they would necessarily be at assassinating, as they've all been placed under this bracket of assassins. With all of that in mind, as we've just spoken about Dudgy, she was able to avoid the wrath of a horde of people, which, to be fair, considering the fact that all of those people would have been normal human beings and she herself would have been a fox spirit, not all that difficult to conceal herself, but also would have avoided the wrathful gaze of Nuar, and let's just assume Erlang Shen and Nja as well. Not that during that time Dudgy would have necessarily wanted to assassinate targets, though the ability to remove people silently would have been a useful asset to her. She snuck around without being detected. Very good on that front. She gets a good rank for that. There was a time in Hindu mythology that the Hindu gods were utterly defeated, and they couldn't stand before the likes of certain demons. Ratibija was a demon with the ability to clone himself. Essentially, if you wounded him, cut off a part of his body, he'd just clone himself. And the more wounds that were inflicted upon him, and the more damage you dealt to him, the stronger the army of Ratibija clones grew. So the gods were overwhelmed by this being. Eventually, the creator goddess, Durga, stood before him, and she at first couldn't defeat him, but got frustrated at this and birthed Kali into existence. Kali defeated Ratibija, and after that, not much is known about what she necessarily did. But suffice it to say, a being that's strong enough to save the Hindu deities from destruction by destroying an enemy that they otherwise had no way of defeating purely through, essentially, brute force, because that's the kind of thing Kali employs. She's the goddess of destruction and time, according to Smite. So she's definitely a candidate for just arguably the outright strongest, most unstoppable assassin. Another candidate for this exact position is Fenrir. See, the gods, knowing what Fenrir would represent, the chaos, torment, and destruction that he would embody through Ragnarok, decided to seal him away. They didn't kill him outright, but was this because they couldn't kill him? Or is this just because of the fact that they didn't want to innocent little? Regardless, he doesn't die, and Fenrir's whole thing is that over time he can gradually become stronger. He can grow and grow and grow and grow, and there's no cap to how much he can actually grow. So given enough time, he could grow to an impossible size, if you allowed it. So potentially, Fenrir could become the strongest deity in the entirety of the game, given enough time. But strength isn't everything. To compare anything to the speed and wit of the messenger would be to compare a hot day to the searing forge of Vulcan, or the blooming rose to the glory of Venus. Mercury is most likely the fastest god in Smite, or at the very least, the fastest assassin in Smite. And there's only, excluding the fact that Kali is a deity of time, one other assassin that could possibly challenge this claim, and we'll get to him in just a second. But at first I figured Thor could possibly challenge this, considering the fact that he controls lightning. Perhaps maybe he has the ability to move at the speed of light, especially because he can teleport to his hammer, and maybe he's moving at the speed of light when he teleports to his hammer. But at the same time, Mercury has this line.
Hey, wanna see me run around the world? Done.
Now, whether or not he can actually move that fast, we would have no way of knowing, because human beings can't detect the speed of light without some sort of machine aid or whatever. So we can't exactly deny his claim that he was able to travel that fast across the Earth. So for now, Mercury is the fastest god until maybe a few minutes until we get into a god that can challenge this. Now, Najjar is someone who you shouldn't underestimate. He was trained by the immortal sage, Tyr Zenrin, who gave him the powerful universal ring and a millery sash. Chinese mythology tells us that the ring was far heavier than a normal human could lift. Yet, Najjar used it with ease, and whilst he was practicing a body of water, he accidentally shook the palace with the ring itself because it was that powerful, and he was that powerful. Alquan got mad, sent a scout, the scout failed to kill Najjar, so Alquan wanted to send his best son to slay Najjar, but the best son was slain. And Alquan is even more mad, but what this does is it shows off the strength of Najjar. He was able to kill the dragon god's son. Dragons were revered as these powerful, mighty creatures in Chinese mythology, so to defeat one, you'd have to be a pretty significant individual. But again, as I said, strength isn't necessarily everything, and to Ratatoska, he uses a lot more of the assassin traits that we were talking about before. Ratatoska, the sly messenger, has lived in the World Tree since time immemorial. We don't even necessarily know the extent to Ratatoska's power. He could be just as powerful as some of the strongest deities in Smite, Zeus, Nox, Thoth, depending on which variation of Thoth's lore Smite has incorporated into his character, or he could be not so powerful, moving towards the bottom of the power gods and goddesses. Nevertheless, there is a certain skill in Ratatoska's kit. Through the cosmos, it allows Ratatoska to hop across branches before ambushing someone. Now, as assassiny as this makes him sound, when he's doing this, the branches aren't named, if they're just some random tree that he's using, or if he's genuinely using the branches of the Tree of Yggdrasil. Or, even more impressively, if he's summoning these branches of the Tree of Yggdrasil to hop on. The Tree of Yggdrasil is supposed to be connected to the Nine Realms, and it's not unfair to assume that it would be connected to the battlegrounds of the gods. So he could simply just be using the branches that extend to this realm to ambush his enemy, but then you have to be considering that he's probably climbing up super high. Like, the ability is called Through the Cosmos, so even though Smite doesn't necessarily represent this all that well, the Tree of Yggdrasil that he's hopping on, he's probably covering an incredible distance. I mean, the skill's called Through the Cosmos for a reason. And to be able to jump from the tree and be able to hit an opponent in such a small space of time is pretty incredible. And if he truly is traveling through the cosmos, well, that seems like it could contend with whatever speed Mercury is able to cover the Earth in. But again, we don't know the specifics of Ratatoska's kit, which is why I'm not sure if he's a true contender to Mercury. But I'll leave it out there. Susanoo was born to rule. Unfortunately, due to certain actions and choices he made, he was cast out of the heavens and forced to rule in the underworld. This is one of those examples where Smite differs from the mythologies, because apparently, according to certain variations of the myth, it's because he had certain feelings for his mother, i.e. he missed his mother, he felt bad for his mother, Izanagi denied any sort of feelings of this nature, and he was banished because of that. And then because of his banishment, that's why he caused all of this ruckus in the heavens. Not a bad trade-off, he's still ruling, but it's not what he wanted. On the plus side, on his way down, he managed to defeat the Orochi, a great beast that had eaten many children. But what's significant about him doing this? Because the Orochi, compared to a lot of the other gods and their feats, slaying a beast like that might not necessarily be all that significant, but he laid down certain baits, traps for the Orochi, and when the Orochi went down to have a feast with its many different heads, he chopped off the heads. And then, when there was a little bit of the beast remaining, he finished it off and was able to uncover a certain sword from its remains. The point is that he didn't necessarily just tackle this beast head on. He used cunning and strategy, a bit like an assassin. He assassinated the beast, really. When punishment is due, there is one from whom even the God of Thunder shrinks. The wrath of wanton gods filling the air with blood and boasts. This battlefield is stained with hubris. Unwittingly, these foolish warriors have summoned their greatest adversary. Nemesis has come. I think that description is fairly self-explanatory as to why she's here. If even Zeus shrinks the knowledge of her presence, well, and is probably extremely powerful. She represents the power of justice. Bastet did battle against the Abbot or Apophis every night before the two slayed each other, but they were resurrected at the start of every day. Most of the Egyptian gods spent a lot of time keeping this beast at bay, and Bastet was the one to commit to the final strike, only to be slain by it, well, fairly often. Her having the power to kill it is definitely something to note. Also, she may have possibly been an Eye of Ra. However, there's not a mention of this or any reference to this in Smite, so we're just going to pretend that she's not an Eye of Ra, as far as her Smite lore is concerned. Moving on to the last god we have here, that's Loki. Now, you're probably thinking that I only put Loki here because I'm something of a Loki fanboy. Not exactly, I wouldn't call myself that, but I do like Loki. But no. See, in Smite's actual story, Loki, with Aokwang and Hel, they slay Zeus, and Loki is the one that actually kills Zeus. It wasn't Aokwang, and it wasn't Hel, they helped, but Loki put a dagger through his chest. Not only that, but Loki then claimed the Master Bolt, stealing it from Hel. If that isn't embodying the traits of an assassin right there, I'm not too sure what else could. He's also considered the trickster god, and it's not like that sort of thing wouldn't help. And out of all the assassins in Smite, Loki's really is the closest to actually what you might consider to be an actual assassin, really. A lot of the other gods in Smite and their kits don't exactly scream assassins. Okay, yes, you've got gods like Serket, Bastet, who, well, yeah, you can kind of see the certain traits of, you know, swift death, a lot of fast, high movement, getting in and out very quickly. But when it comes to the pure assassination and what the assassins represent, that's Loki to a T. But when it comes to the strongest, I think you're looking at Kali, Nijar, Daji, Susanoo, Nemesis, and Thor. The only reason I'm not including Ratatoska here is just because his strength is very ambiguous. Just because he was around from the beginning of time itself doesn't necessarily mean that he's necessarily an incredibly powerful being. It might just be that he's immortal and cannot die. He cannot be removed from the equation. Immortality by itself isn't necessarily everything. Bastet, we know, can be killed. We know Daji can be killed. And we know Nijar can be killed. We also know that Thor can be killed. It's been prophesized. So that just leaves Nemesis and Kali. Now Kali, I have no idea whether or not she can be killed, but in her mythology and myths and stories, she's never really been put under threat of actually dying or being murdered or removed in any way. Nemesis has been put under certain threats within her mythology and her stories, but the Greek gods have been proven time and time again to be pretty much immortal, unless someone removes that immortality factor. And I don't necessarily see Kali being the type of person to necessarily remove that. In terms of the strongest gods that are assassins in Smite, in my opinion, it's a tie between Kali and Nemesis. So I suppose for me, it really just comes down to a question of, does justice override the utter ability to crush and destroy everything, i.e. destruction itself, or is destruction so powerful that the idea of justice just crumbles should it ever try to challenge destruction in and of itself? But that's just my opinion. What do you think? Do you think there are actually stronger gods? Perhaps Thor's feat of actually lifting Jormungandr out of the sea is far too impressive to ignore. Or perhaps there's a lot more than Susanoo being born to rule than I really considered. Let me know your thoughts in the comment section below. And if you enjoyed the video, feels like it enjoys it, well, a like is all the rage right now. And of course, subscribe to the channel and hit that notification bell as well, if you would. And until the next video, have a very good day. I have been Prime, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye-bye.